what happened. I was in college. It was the early 1980s. I was a serious guy. I want to talk about something that happened that was both good for me and bad for me at the same time. I was a very serious guy as a college student. No social skills, socially awkward, and I was out of balance. Definitely, I was an out of balance guy. And I was studying English. I was studying writing. I think it was my father who actually pushed me in that direction. He saw that that was probably where my best talents were going to be. So he kind of encouraged me to go into writing, become an English major. And I met people, in those classes. And I also met an intellectual. I was working at a wine store in Berkeley. And what happened was I read three novels in my early 20s. It changed my whole life and made me want to become a novelist. One novel was called The Confederacy of Dunces by John Kennedy Toole. It's a beloved comic novel starring Ignatius J. Riley, this fat guy who's keeping a journal under his bed, thinks he's going to save the world. He uses lots of big words. He's so beloved. I believe in Louisiana, the French Quarter, they have a statue erected in his honor. I've never been to Louisiana, but from what I've read, he is a beloved character. The second novel I read that changed my life was Portnoy's Complaint by Philip Roth. What a work of catharsis. And man, he went and he took a deep dive in that novel, man. I mean, no taboos in that novel, man. He went down into the nitty gritty of the situation, man. And he was funny. And what shows have I watched that have no taboos? Well, there was The League, no taboos in that, which I enjoyed. And I think Big Mouth, which had no taboos. I can go down there, man, sometimes. Definitely don't have any. Well, anyways. And the third novel that was life-changing for me was The Ginger Man by J.P. Donleavy. And what these three novels did, if I could compare them all, is they opened up the door to humor. I had no idea that comedy and humor were such a big deal, but I should have, because, you know, my father and I, you know, I think the things that bonded us were comedians. I mean, in the 60s, the Smothers Brothers, there was Red Skelton, Jonathan Winters, Jackie Gleason, and then in the 70s, we used to just die from laughing from George Carlin. So I shouldn't have surprised me when I was in college that it was the comic novel. Now, the novel, those three novels I mentioned, they were so full of impact for me that I wanted to become a novelist. I mean, I became obsessed. I have to be a novelist. There's nothing else in life. I have one of those lame, all-or-nothing personalities. And it just, after I read those three novels, okay, there's nothing else. There's nothing else in life except to make people laugh by writing comic novels like this. So I attempted to become a novelist and didn't work out too well. I would say from the late 1980s to the early 2000s, I wrote maybe over a dozen novels, and they were all failures. Now, believe it or not, in the summer of 2017, I spent 2 months writing a comic novel that takes place on a community college campus while a very unpopular president is residing, and it was based on obviously current political landscape. Thought that one was a little better, but who knows? You know, I don't really want to talk about that novel because I'm not sure it fits in with what I want to tell you. That novel might be better than the other ones, but I just think that writing is so competitive. Even if the most recent novel I wrote is pretty good, I'm not sure that's good enough. What I really want to talk about are the novels that I just plowed through, man. I used to just sit down and I wrote so many novels in such a short period of time, and they were all failures. And it's really those novels that I want to talk about. Though the one I wrote in the summer only took me 2 months to write, so that's kind of part and parcel of my method, my MO, if you will. So who knows? We could put that in here too. So I want to go over the 10 reasons that I failed as a novelist. Maybe if you're an aspiring novelist, you'll learn something from this. And number one, I became too intoxicated by my own premises. And what happens when you fall in love with your own premise too much, too often, for me anyways, it made me keep my eye off doing other important things like character development. For an example, my first novel was called Herculage. It was a futuristic dystopian society that this novel I wrote in 1989. It was inspired by an article I read in the newspaper about Italy, Italian police escorting overweight people off of nude beaches because they didn't look good. It wasn't good for tourism. So I created this society where you had to look good. If you were walking around and you had cellulite exposure, you'd get a cellulite violation, like a parking ticket or a speeding ticket. And I thought it was so funny. But the problem was, you know, then I had to hang a plot on a thin joke. And I did that too often. You know, that might have been a good Saturday Night Live skit for comedy writing, but it didn't make a novel. So I think the thin premise, getting too intoxicated by the humor of it, and then not having the necessary plot and character development to really carry the novel through. Number two, I enticed too many agents with my funny premises and with my fantastic cover letters. I wrote great synopses of my novels. And the agents loved them. They would invite me to send the whole novel, and the novels would be flaccid. They would be a dud. And so, you know, the literary community is pretty small. I'm sure the agents know each other. Even this is before the internet. And, the dude's a dud. The dude ain't delivering me squat, man. So I probably created a bad reputation for myself by being in such a rush to show these agents how funny I was with my premise, and then to show them what a good writer I was with a synopsis. I got news for you. Writing a one or two page synopsis, even if it's amazing, doesn't equal a 300 page novel. That's what I found out the hard way. Number three. What I learned is to be a novelist, you have to be a marathon runner. I'm not a marathon runner. I'm a wind sprinter. I'm more of a short story writer. I'm more of a dude who likes to write criticism, analysis. It's just how I'm tempered. It's how I'm hardwired. So really not the marathon runner that you have to be a novelist. Number four. I never really had a fondness for excessive rewriting. But you have to be an excessive rewriter. You know, the published writer, Christopher Isherwood, who wrote the screenplay for the Evelyn Waugh novel, The Loved One, one of my favorite cult movie classics. When asked how he became such a good writer, he said, "Well, I'm not a good writer. I'm a good rewriter." And that's the thing, man. If you don't have fondness for rewriting your material, you're going to be hitting a plateau. And that's one of the reasons why I failed. Number five. You know, when I read The Ginger Man and when I read Portnoy's Complaint and The Confederacy of Dunces, I think I became more intoxicated by the romantic idea of becoming a novelist than actually doing the drudge work, the tedium of becoming a novelist. All the alone time, all the patience, all the rewriting, all the aggravation, all the torture. I think I was more into the idea of it. And that was one of the reasons why I failed. Number six is embarrassing, but I got to be honest. I was too full of myself to be a good novelist. I felt that I had this special brand X inside me. So it was so special that the McMahon secret sauce would compensate for any flaws in my novel. And I was wrong. And that's, that. You know, I have to suffer the consequences for being too full of myself. Number seven, I have a short attention span. You know, to write a novel, you got to live inside that novel universe for 2, 3, 4, 5 years. I get claustrophobic. I get antsy. I want to get the hell out. And so I feel like I have a short attention span. I may even have ADHD. Number eight, this is embarrassing. I think I was more hell-bent on fame and glory than I was on writing a really good novel. That didn't help me. Number nine, I don't think I ever created a character that I was in love enough to spend 2, 3, 4, 5 years with. I wanted to get the heck out. And number 10, I don't think I spent enough time developing descriptive writing skills. If you're going to be a successful novelist, you need to immerse the reader into a very tactile physical world, a place that that reader's never been before with really elaborate descriptive writing skills. John Updike could do it. If we're going to use a contemporary example, pick up a novel that was published in July of 2017. It's called Beautiful Animals. It's by Lawrence Osborne. I believe he's a British author. And this novel is set on an island in Greece. And he takes you there, man. You are in Greece. You are on an island. You are by the ocean, man. You are in the gardens. You're hanging out with rich people in their rich villas and their rich mansions. You're hanging out, man. You see these people. You see the place. He puts you in a very tactile world. I mean, he's like the best. There are a few people who can take you to that world. That would be number 10. So what's my conclusion on all this? If a young person was talking to me about becoming a novelist, I would recommend two books. Neither of them are about writing novels specifically, but I do think they address the work ethic of becoming a novelist in a general sense. And they're both by the same author. His name's Cal Newport. And one book is called Deep Work. And the other book is, he took the title of his other book from a quote from the comedian Steve Martin, "So good, they can't ignore you." And what he's really doing in both books is he's encouraging you to become a craftsman. He's encouraging you to get off, the internet and to get off multitasking and to go into deep work, to time block your days and be a person of habit, be a person of discipline. And that you can't overcome your plateaus in whatever art you do or science or whatever passion that you have unless you go through the drudgery of deep work. I would recommend those two books before anything. So that's pretty much it. I felt I had to do this to help anyone out who has aspirations to become a novelist. It's kind of painful doing that. I'm not sure I wanted to divulge all that, but that's just the way it goes, ladies and gentlemen. And until next time, I am out.